But what I'm really interested in, and especially this is one of the reasons why I wanted to do this workshop, is because I really want teachers to learn how to teach science. And I really want people to understand what actually science means, okay? Science is a very, it's a framework in which we think, okay? And I'm gonna spend this whole lecture lying to you and cheating you out of all these things, and you'll still think, and at the end of the day, you'll believe in science, right? So one of the first things, right, that I'm gonna tell you is a body, when set in uniform motion, what happens to it, right? It keeps going on forever and ever. So if I get this tennis ball and I roll it on the floor, well, according to what I just told you, right, it should be carry on rolling on forever and ever. So why didn't that happen? Right, but remember now, okay? I'm a complete idiot, okay? I know nothing. So my next question is, like, what's a force? Push or a pull? So that's going to lead us now, right, into what was it? The second law of motion, right? Which is the law of inertia. If I push on an object of mass 1 kilogram with a force of 1 newton, right? It moves at an acceleration of 1 meter. I'm gonna tell you, all my lecture is about the number 1. It's my favorite number, I use it all the time. It's very good for dividing, multiplying, it's great. It's actually quite an interesting prime number as well. But the reason why I'm telling you this, right, is that we have mass, right, in it. Now, if I tell you what mass is, right, I'd ask you, what does mass mean? So imagine, right, we've built this great radio telescope here on Earth, and we've discovered extraterrestrial intelligence. And now we need to describe our world to these people, okay, our science to these people. So the first thing you would say, for example, right, well, you know, say you're trying to describe yourself, you say, well, I'm actually, you know, 6 feet tall, or I'm 1 foot tall, 6 foot tall, I weigh, let us say, 80 kilograms. So the quest, so the person on the other side, this Martian, or this person we find, says, well, actually, what do you mean by 6 feet? What's a foot? And I start thinking, oh, hang on a minute. Now I need to tell you what a distance is. And the question is, then, how do you define a distance, right? So what do you think we'd use to define a distance? A measure of space, so that's right. But how am I going to tell them what to measure? The length from point to point. But which point and to which point? All right, but how do I explain to them what a neutron is? I mean, that's pretty difficult. Right, okay, so that's a good... That's right. Exactly. So, but what's hydrogen? But what's an element? So the question is, you go deeper and deeper, and that's what the scientific method is. Now, the one thing we could say, right, between us and them, right, is that there are constants throughout our universe that are always equal, right? What is the most famous one? The speed of light, right? That's my favorite constant. Now, the speed of light is what? It's 186,000 miles per second, or one. In fact, that's what all the theoretical physicists do. They set it to one straight away. But what does it actually mean, 3 × 10⁸ meters per second? I mean, you think it's pretty fast, right? It is quite fast. You can't really go any faster if you tried. But what it actually means, right, is it travels 30 centimeters in 1 nanosecond. Now, how many of you remember the Pentium computers? You remember when we had processors of 1 gigahertz?
Just the front row.
What does that, what does it, what the? So what does 1 gigahertz mean, right? What does a clock of 1 gigahertz mean? It means it takes a tick, right? Every what? Every 1 nanosecond. So in the tick that it takes, between one tick and another, light just about crosses your laptop. That's how fast the speed of light is. In between the clock tick of your processor, it has this. So now we have a way of explaining to this Martian, well, you know, you take the speed of light, that's excellent, and then you, well, we have to see how far light travels from this distance to this distance, and then we have a way of measuring this height. And they have to agree with us, right? Because the speed of light is constant. Now, if the speed of light weren't constant, we'd have a really big problem. But we also have another problem, right? What if the laws of physics that we have here are different to the laws of physics that we have there? And this is actually one of the most interesting things, right? So let me explain to you what is the most interesting thing about the laws of physics. So if I drop this ball here, right, what's going to happen? I see we have some observational people in the audience. Excellent. Well, that's an acceleration, not a speed, but yes. Now look, I'm going to tell you the next most interesting thing about the laws of physics. Watch this. What happened? Same thing, right? What does that mean? It means that the laws of physics are unchanged on translation in direction, and also what happened by the time I came here, in time, right? This is the next really most important thing that physicists discovered. If I turn at 45 degrees, what happens? There's also the same thing with rotation. Now that's really important, right, if you think about it. Because imagine it wasn't the case. Imagine how annoying it would be. Every time we rotated a little bit more throughout the day, the laws of physics would change. Because the Earth is rotating, so we're rotating. So every time this happens, it rotates. Now there's this beautiful theorem, and absolutely, it's a marvelous theorem, that says for every symmetric thing, i.e. translational symmetry, right? It happens to say the same thing. There exists a conservation law, okay? So the translational symmetry that says you can move to change in x, that corresponds, okay, once you do some beautiful mathematics, to the conservation of linear momentum, okay? What do you think the rotation one counts as? Conservation of angular momentum, perfect. And then we have the other one, translation in time, right? What is that? The conservation of? There are three things we conserve most of the time in physics. Energy, exactly, that's right. So now it's really good, right? Because now we also have a measure of how to tell the Martians how much I weigh, how much things, what the energy is, because the energy is a constant. And this is basically great, right? Because what I'm saying is that now I can have a measure of how to describe the contents of the universe. In fact, when you think about it, right, what we're actually doing is always telling people what energy is. And actually, energy is quite a strange thing, right? We basically invented it. So what's happening when I do this, right? I'm converting what kind of energy to? That's right, potential to kinetic energy. But it's funny, right? Because the whole thing is a constant. It's always a constant. Now you'll hear people, and you hear things like, for example, like dark energy, right? It's always pulling this thing. Now, has dark energy, it seems to be constant, right? It has to be constant. And yet it's always pulling and acting in the same direction. So it's very strange. But the other thing that is strange that you want to kind of explain, right, is forces and how forces act. And so one of my favorite things is the pendulum. So everyone knows, everyone's seen a pendulum before? Basically like this. I actually cut it to be 1 meter long. It's my favorite length. Now what happens, right, when I swing the pendulum, right? It swings back and forward. Now, if you think about it, right, it's actually brilliant. So imagine you come up with a theory, okay, and many people come up with crazy theories all the time. I receive them in the post, they're great. Saying, well, at this point, oops, it's accelerating in this direction, it passes the center point and immediately knows to start accelerating in the other direction. Well, what's happening? How does it know? How does it know where the zero point is? Imagine there are like little angels pushing the ball always this way. It comes to zero, starts pushing them always this way. Well, you think, well, a lot of people have this theory for a very long time, actually. We just think now that the angels push in different directions. So what's happening, right? This is what's always happening. And what it knows, right, is it knows where the equilibrium position is and where it's basically, where it stops, where it kind of all the energy things balance out. Now, it's also very good, right? Because once I have this, I basically have a clock, right? If I do it at 1 meter, and I start doing this, oh, now I've got a clock. This is excellent. Now I can start telling them what clocks are and things like this. I have a clock and I have a length. But what happens if I change the length of the pendulum, right? So if I do this and I make it a little bit shorter, what happens now, right? The period changes. Does anyone know exactly how the period changes? Well, I know George knows. If George didn't know, we'd be in a real lot of trouble. It goes at the square root of the length, right? And this is also actually true, right? If we set this, and this is all to teach you about circular orbits, by the way. If you set this in motion in a circle, right, like this, right? As if you did any A-level physics, or those who did A-level physics, you know, right? The acceleration is what in a circular thing? Centripetal, right? Always pointing to the center, and it goes as the velocity squared. What does it go as? V squared over r, right? Over the radius. Now this is great, right? Because I'm a very lazy person, so I don't want to stay talking up all the time. So I'm going to write down some equations. So what I have now, right, is that the centripetal acceleration is V squared over R. So is everyone happy with this?
No, I can't see it.
Yeah. Problem over D. Yes.
So this is probably the most important equation of the. Now, in this case, right, the V squared over R was kept by the tension of the spring, right? In case of gravity, right, what keeps the things in orbit, right? What is the law of gravitation?
The equation.
Yes, the equation. Makes no difference. Well done, if I write to where Galileo arrived a few hundred years ago. Okay, this is basically what it says. What does it also tell me? If I remove one R and R over here, it tells me that the velocity of this, goes the square root of Gm over R. Is everyone happy with this? Because this is where we get dark matter from. You better get ready for this. Now, the law of gravity, right, is a very interesting law. And it's very similar to other laws, okay? Nature has this way of teasing us, okay? So imagine you're Mars, and you're looking at the sun, right? So what do? You say, I need to calculate where I'm going to be around my orbit. So what do? You look at the sun. This is Mars, the planet. You weigh it. Say, that weighs quite a lot. You calculate the distance. You take the inverse square of that distance. Work out the velocity you need to move and move. Okay, does anyone find this strange? Because this is what someone wrote about gravity. That one body, Robert, can you turn off the lights, please? That one body may act upon another at a distance through a vacuum without the mediation of anything else, by and through which direction and force may be conveyed from one another, is to me so great an absurdity that I believe no man who has in philosophic matters a competent faculty of thinking could ever fall into it. Yeah, do you know who said this? Isaac Newton. That's right. So now what I'm going to tell you about, once I've set the stage, okay, the stage is that equation, V equals square root Gm over R. Now I'm going to tell you why we need dark matter. In fact, you're going to convince me that we need dark matter. You're going to tell me, Chris, you have to put dark matter in. I'll tell you, no, I don't want to put dark matter. I want to invent every other equation, but I don't want to put dark matter in. Then you're going to tell me, where is the dark matter? Because now that you've told me you need it, we have to put it somewhere. And then you're going to tell me, what is the dark matter made of? And then I'm going to give you a Nobel Prize. Oops. what's wrong with these projectors? Here we go. This is the solar system that we all know and love, okay? You can see this, that star in the center, we call it the sun, for no real reason, we just call it that. Then there's Mercury, it's been causing us trouble, Mercury, from the very beginning. Then Venus is quite neutral, there's Earth, which we're lucky to be on. Behind us there's Mars, and then there's Jupiter and Saturn. But if I plot, okay, the reason why I'm telling you this is that all the orbits, right, are walking around the sun all the time according to that velocity. Looking at the sun, weighing it, calculating the inverse square distance of it, using the force and moving across. All the time, every second, every nanosecond, almost at the speed of light, if we believe that gravity travels at the speed of light. It might travel at another speed. And if I plot it on a radial diagram, so on the x-axis now is the radius, is the distance, okay, of the planet to the sun. And I plot it like this, okay, and I plot the velocity on the y-axis and the distance from the sun on the x-axis. You see, I have Mercury, I have Venus, I have the Earth, I have Mars, I have Jupiter, Saturn, Neptune, and Uranus. Now, in fact, and this is the strength of the scientific method, okay, that when you calculate and you have a theory that actually works, not only does your theory explain things, but if your theory is good, you can predict things. And this is how, okay, Le Verrier discovered Neptune. He was calculating the orbits, he was seeing the things. And that is why the scientific method is important, because if you have a good theory, you can now start to say things. Well, there should be another planet. Okay, and that was exactly how Neptune was discovered. So by knowing your theory and having a good theory, you can also make predictions. And this is what we always try to do in science. We try to predict how things are going forward. The other thing that you can do if you're measuring very, very accurately, okay, and now we're coming back up to 20th century physics, okay? This was, we were in Newton's times, and Newton, you know, he was sitting on the throne for a very long time. The throne of gravity was belonged to him for hundreds of years. Until someone came along and started measuring the, what we call the perihelion, but it sounds great, but it's actually quite a simple thing. It's basically the semi-minor axis, or the short part of the ellipse. If you have an ellipse, right, which is not a perfect circle, one part is the short part, and the other part is the long part, okay? The perihelion is the short part, and the aphelion is the long part. What they realized, that every time that Mercury went around the sun, this perihelion started changing. And it started changing by a tiny amount, like, I mean, a complete fraction of a thing. But that's why the scientific method is great, because if you have a theory, from the theory, what do? You compute where you predict the orbit. Then you measure it. If your theory doesn't agree with measurement, throw it away. Away. We don't need it anymore. Very good, very nice. Thanks for all the fish. Get out. And this is what was happening, right? They were calculating that every time that Mercury moved, the perihelion, so that distance changes by 2 degrees in 100 years. That's how amazing you have to be at the time to measure the difference. And this is the beauty of nature, right? As they say, subtle is the Lord. That to explain this really tiny phenomenon, okay, this 2 degrees per century, you know, 2 degrees per century, I would probably say, oh, it's nothing really much. But that's not what science is. Science is about getting the exact thing. Einstein had to change the entire face of gravity, the entire way we think about gravity, in order to explain these 2 degree things. Now, there are obviously other theories, and today, between us, we'll all come up with theories of dark matter. So Einstein basically said that it's not only X, Y, Z, and time that has things, but they're actually one whole thing. Now, that's really weird if you think about it, right? Because you have this fabric in four dimensions. Now, I can barely think in 3 dimensions, let alone in 4. So, but he basically combined the equations, and he did some beautiful mathematics that basically said, if you have mass, it basically bends space-time in such a way that these things. Now, you also need to know something else about nature, that nature is the second laziest thing you'll ever meet. I'll tell you why it isn't the laziest. If nature was lazy, it wouldn't have done anything. We wouldn't have done anything. Why create a universe? Just don't do anything. However, the second lazy is because it always chooses the shortest way. It always chooses the shortest path from A to B. Now, the crazy thing is this. It's something that I don't really understand. How does it know? How does nature know which is the shortest path? How does it know that to get from A to B, the shortest path is a straight line? As you know, when all of you get stuck in traffic, sometimes you take a longer route and you get there quicker. So why doesn't nature do that? And in fact, this was one of the things that Richard Feynman did, right? Actually, Richard Feynman said, nature tries them all very quickly, faster than you can ever tell, and always picks the right one. Now, that's almost as crazy as looking at the sun, calculating the mass, taking the inverse square distance and saying, I'm going to move this way now. But actually, what has happened is that you have no choice. Your free will is removed from this because the space-time which you're going in is already rolling around, so you can only roll. And this is one of the things. Now, people think that one of the consequences of this was that we have black holes. Actually, it is. It does fall out of the equations. But I can tell you that even in Newtonian time, we could have derived the equation for a black hole. If over there, that velocity v, I changed it for the speed of light, which is the fastest thing you could ever have, right? Then I have the mass and the radius of a black hole. In fact, when you work out through all Einstein's equations and you do loads of maths and things, you find out that it's only a slight correction, but it's the correction that was needed to bring gravity into the understanding that we have today. And I can tell you that even today, we don't understand gravity. We don't understand dark energy. Dark matter, we have a much better idea about, and this is why I'm going to explain to you. So, do you remember this graph? Okay, everything is doing great. It's falling as the square root of the distance. Okay, if I plotted it on a log graph, it would be a negative straight line with gradient a half. And then we started looking. So far, right? We're still in our solar system. Imagine how good our test bed of the solar system is. If you come up with a theory, okay, a theory of gravity, and people come up with these theories all the time. George has a favorite one. Everyone has a favorite one. Whoever you speak to in the street will tell you has a favorite one. If it doesn't pass those solar system tests, throw it away. But now that we started looking outside the solar system, right, we started looking at the orbits. And if you see, we have a beautiful galaxy, right? It's a spiral galaxy, and you can see all the arms rotating. But now you need to say, how do I measure the velocity in the spiral arms? Because before you had a planet, you had a big round thing. You look at it and you say, it's moved this much. I take my protractor, it's moved this much. I take my protractor, it's moved this much. But now you don't have that. So what do you have? You have light, right? Exactly. So you need to measure the light. Now it turns out that hydrogen, the simplest atom, is a solar system of its own. Instead of gravity, there's something that's called electromagnetism. It works in exactly the same way, roughly. Actually, you can actually show that electromagnetism is also part of gravity. If you manage to do that, you probably also win. But all it is, right, is the same thing, the same mv squared over r, okay, because it's something in a circular motion. But now instead of gmm over r squared, what do I have? I have the charge, right? The positive charge and the electric charge. I have electricity, the Coulomb force. Q1, Q2 over R squared. Look how cool it is, this Coulomb force. It even goes as the square of the distance. The electron counts how many protons there are, calculates the distance between the electron and the nucleus, as Ed was saying yesterday, right? The electrons are out there in the stadium. It sees the fly. It calculates how many protons there are in the fly. Takes the inverse square distance. I mean, if you're taking the inverse square distance, it's already a difficult thing. And moves in exactly the right direction. I mean, that's incredible. At the same time, it's calculating its mass, the mass of the proton, and saying, take the inverse square distance. Luckily, I worked it out for the Coulomb force. And falling under gravity towards it. Thankfully, it's much lighter. But what happens when this electron moves from one circular orbit to another? Okay, what happens? The energy changes, right? Because at first it was high up in the orbit, and now it's lower down in the orbit. As it changes energy, what does it do? The energy has to go somewhere. It emits light. Now that's what you just said now is exactly what Richard Feynman won the Nobel Prize for. Okay, it's basically quantum electrodynamics. He worked out the way exactly an electron, when it falls from one thing to another, basically emits light. And it emits light, very luckily, at very particular wavelengths. Okay? If it falls from the n equals 2 to the n equals 1 shell, it gives out light somewhere in the red spectrum. N equals 3 to n equals 2 is exactly in the red part of the spectrum. It can also absorb light. If it was in the second orbit and it absorbs light from something, it goes up to the third one, okay? And so on and so forth. And it emits these lines. Now, this is great, because I can speak to my Martian and tell her, "Ho patencia, look a little bit at the sun. Tell me how much hydrogen you're seeing over there. I weigh one over 1 billionth of that. That's how much I weigh." Explaining to people the things like this are very difficult. I'll give you an exercise. How would you, let us say the Martian knows who I am, and she's saying, okay, but what are you made of? And I tell her, well, actually, I'm this thing, I have these prongs sticking out of my hands. Inside me, I have my heart. My heart is to the left of my symmetrical. And she says, hang on, what's left? Now you're in a very tricky situation, because how do you explain what left and right is to someone else? You have to start from an origin. But the other interesting thing about light, right, is that it turns either towards the right or towards the left, right? What is known as polarization, right? So you could tell her, okay, there are these molecules that basically change light always in the same direction. Tell her, can you go and get some of these molecules? Sugar, for example, is one of them. It's how we measure sugar content in things. Point this sugar thing to the sun. See the light coming out of the sun with a polarizer, work out which way it's coming out, and that's my left. That concept of left and right is also an important concept in physics. Okay, we call it parity. We give it a new thing, and it's called parity. Okay, it means if I go from plus x to minus x around my thing, either I remain the same. Thank God, in my case, I remain the same. There are some particles that flip. Okay, like the electron, for example, it flips. These are very important things, okay? Because these are the things you'd have to explain to this person. The other thing we have, okay, and this is my favorite emission, okay, basically because I build radio telescopes to detect this, is the 21-centimeter emission line. The proton and the electron have spin. Not only are they spinning in the orbit, okay, they have another spin about their axis, a bit like the Earth. If you had to spin the axis of the Earth completely upside down, okay, so you put the north to south and things like this, okay, you'd have to put a force, you'd have to put a torque. In fact, you can show this and you can show it to the students, which is a great one. If you start off with a bicycle wheel and you're sitting on a rotating chair, if you rotate the bicycle wheel 180 degrees, you'll find that your chair starts spinning. Okay, this is basically because you've put a torque by changing it around this way and you start spinning. That's exactly what happens. Okay, in the 21 centimeter line. Luckily for us, okay, the 21 centimeter line is at a frequency of 1.4 gigahertz, so it's quite easy. Unluckily for us, we decided to put all our communications, GPS, and all those things around 1.4 gigahertz. So this is why you spend a lot of time going to deserts away from people to look for these things. So you're nearly going to convince me that we need dark matter. Just a little bit more. The other thing that you have to bear in mind, right, is that even though this light in its rest frame, now I'll tell you what a rest frame is. It means when I, the observer, is still, okay, emits this light at 21 centimeters. As you know, if I start moving towards the source, right, what happens? We get Doppler shifted. The frequency changes according to how fast I'm moving towards the source or how fast the source is moving away from us. Now, this is great. Why is this great? Because this is what we need to measure speed. If there's a hydrogen atom moving in the spiral arm of the galaxy far away from me, it gets redshifted away from me. So I can start calculating out the velocities. And this is what I calculate, okay? So I have the rotational speed of the Milky Way. Okay. If I look at the spiral arms, okay, in one of them I measure 200 kilometers per second, another 250 kilometers per second, 240, 220. So what do I do in order to make a pretty picture? Okay, this is what they actually look like in radio. So you can see our spiral galaxy. Atomic hydrogen is shown in blue, 2.6 microns, which is the color green, is shown in green, and 24 microns is shown in red. But what I really want to tell you, this pretty picture is just gratuitous to show this graph, is that the velocity that I'm seeing is actually remaining constant as I go further out, instead of dropping as I expected, right? As I sort of, if I go to what I expect, okay, the distance from the center of the galaxy outward. So on the x-axis is r, on the y-axis is velocity. It's remaining constant. So now we need something, right? Something's gone terribly wrong in our theory. Don't spoil it. We're supposed to be building up towards dark matter. Now, let us say, I'm going to tell you it's not really dark matter, it's not true. I'm going to tell you that the laws of physics change after a certain distance. The law of gravity at a certain radius changes. The mass starts to change. Okay, this is known as modified Newtonian dynamics. Okay, it was thought of in the 1980s, and people still go on about it. But the thing is this, right? What do you need mathematically? So we go to our theorists and we tell them, what do we need in order for us to get this graph to look flat? So we know that there is that graph that is true, right? We need another term in our equation. We need to add something in order to take the graph from looking like this to looking flat. So we need to add something, right? What shape would you guess we need to add? Mm-hmm. That's right. So we need to add, but before we do that, we are going to do that. But how do I need to modify this equation? I need to add something to this equation, right? I can either add more mass, as you're saying, like this, but it also I need to add something which related to R, right? Because I can't. Let me tell you why. Because if I did exactly what you said, then in the solar system, all those orbits would be wrong. All the orbits that you have of Mercury, of Saturn. So your theory. But it is correct. I just showed you all the orbits, Madoffi. You're not going to believe me. what more evidence do you need? No, but you need to add something. You're right, right? So let's add something that looks. So I have. Sorry. Actually, I think I have it. Here we go. So this is what the observed matter looks like, which is the green line. Okay, that's the velocity again on the distance. And now I'm adding this equation, right? This equation is increasing, you're seeing? It's increasing with distance. Why is it increasing with distance? It's important that it's very small at very small distances. Why? Because it has to agree with the solar system tests. If it didn't agree with the solar system tests, it would be wrong. But it has to increase and take over this graph in order to add the required amount in order to get the flat thing. So you look at the rotation curves and it looks a bit like this. This is an observed thing. Now you might have some other colleagues in the nuclear physics department or in the particle physics department, and it tells you, well, this looks a really lot like this. This is the binding energy of nucleons. This tells you how much energy you need to put into a nucleus in order to remove a proton or a neutron. So if you look at over here, okay, this is the atomic weight. Okay, so hydrogen is down here, helium is down here, and this is the amount of energy you need to put in. Okay, so the amount of kinetic energy, if you like, to put in to remove the thing. Okay, this is, if you look at it, it's a bit similar, right? It's basically peaking and it's staying flat. This graph also tells you, okay, why iron is the most stable element, because you have to put in the most energy to remove it and to break up iron. Okay, this is why we see so many iron core supernova and iron core collapses. So now, So now we have this theory of dark matter. Okay, we've basically we're saying the dark matter looks like this. If I plot it, okay, on a graph, on a picture, it looks a bit like that. And I think I have an even better picture, which looks a bit like this. Okay, this is showing the dark matter in red, which we don't see at all. Okay, and how it's keeping the different outer arms of the galaxies all rotating at the same time. So now, thank God, we've actually explained what the dark matter rotation curves are. But we've done it for a galaxy. So if this is true, we can start to think now about what the galactic dark matter might be. We know it isn't gas, dust, or stars, right? Because otherwise we'd see them. They interact with the electromagnetic light. They shine, they reflect, and absorb. It can either be some massive compact halo objects, i.e. some things that are very, very compact, that are so compact we don't have the resolution with our telescopes to see them, and they're very, very heavy, and they're very, very dense. Or the other thing that they could be is weakly interacting massive particles, which are known as WIMPs, or neutrinos, which are my favorite, but anyway, or some exotic particle physics. But the thing is, now we know what the dark matter is and things. We don't know what it is. We know how it behaves, really. We know how it behaves with radius. The next thing you want to do, if you know where it is or how it is, what you would like to do is map it out and find out exactly where it is, if it actually exists. And luckily enough, we can do this with a thing called gravitational lensing. Now, gravitational lensing is basically, I think, the greatest tool that we have for a very long time. And the reason being, right, is that if you look at the position of a star, okay, if you look at it on the boundary between the sun and the star, you can actually see a little bit of a deflection. Okay, this was calculated by Einstein, which is his theory of relativity, and then about, I think, 1919, Arthur Eddington did a trip to, I think it was Patagonia. He looked for the eclipse, right? He needed the eclipse to make sure that basically it was everything perfectly aligned, and he could see exactly the bending. And he worked out, and that was basically the confirmation of general relativity. One of the things. So the lensing was definitely there. And you can do this lensing part, right, from all the physics that you learned from GCSE, from your O level, right? What does it tell you? If you put a lens like this, right, the light bends. If you make the lens thicker, right, this is like people who need glasses. What happens, right? The light bends more. So if you put thicker and thicker things, right, you can get more and more bending. Up to a point that if you are over here as an observer and you know what your light source is over there, because they taught you, Chiara, Ed, and Jim taught you how to measure luminosity, so you know how bright they are, you can calculate how thick your lens is. Now, this is amazing, right? Because you can calculate how thick your lens is. You can also measure how bright the stuff is that is causing the lensing. And now you're going to find out that there's actually missing matter. Okay, this is what Zwicky did. In the 20s and the 30s. He saw how much there was, he saw how luminous it was, calculated the mass according to the luminosity, and then said, hang on a minute, I'm out by a factor of 100 here. And this is exactly what's happening, okay? You have the distant quasar, okay, quasi-stellar object, the furthest things away from the universe. They go through our galaxy, for example, and come down to Earth being focused down. Now I'll show you. So now you can see, right? The great thing about the universe is that there are a really lot of galaxies and a really lot of stuff to help us practice to test our theories on. So you can have all these different kinds of lensing. You can have the converging lens, as you know from physics. You can have a diverging lens, etc. So you can have anti-gravity lensing, for example, that is pushing things further away. So we have a lot of tools here for which to study. And in fact, this is how beautiful they are, okay? These are like clusters of galaxies over here, so you can see, okay? There are over here about 10 in a particular cluster. Our Milky Way is in a cluster, and just recently, just this year, we're part of a super cluster now. So these are the biggest gravitationally bound objects that we have in our universe. And if you if you plot it along a line of sight, okay? You can measure a galaxy over there, okay? It comes through this cluster of galaxies, okay? And from the Earth, you measure how much it's lensing, right? How much is bending down? Now I'm going to tell you why this is exciting, because this is exactly what I spend half of my life doing. You can also look, okay, at this distance galaxy coming through the lens, coming down to Earth. And if I show you what it looks like, right, this is exactly what it looks like. This is known as an Einstein ring. And by getting that radius of the ring, you can calculate how much mass there is, because it's telling you how much is deflected from either side. But what's even more interesting than that, is something that looks like this, right? This is a cluster of galaxies, okay? And you can see there are various Einstein rings over here. There's one here, there's one at various rings, and there are also different galaxies. Now, what I spend and what cosmologists spend a lot of time, and now we're spending a lot of money on, is sending up satellites, okay, like the Euclid satellite is going to be next, to measure the ellipticity of the galaxy. Because the ellipticity of the galaxy, and more importantly, the statistical distribution of that ellipticity, okay, tells you what the lens is made of. Why? Because let me tell you, I'm going to explain to you why. It's quite easy. You'd expect that everything is randomly distributed, okay? Because when the universe exploded from the Big Bang, right? Everything was random. So when you're seeing something that is not random, something must have happened. It cannot be, right? If all of a sudden you're seeing them all aligned along this circle, you don't think, this was God having fun with a compass. He got a compass, he drew a circle on the sky and decided to put galaxies across it. Why would he do that? Why would he pick that? So something must be bending the light in a very particular way, right, to do this. And from that particular way, we can map out what the lens is and what is causing the deflection of the light. And if you look at it, right, okay, you can see, so this is the first map made of dark matter, one of the first, was a Nature paper. The red is X-ray emission, okay, which is showing the hot gas, okay, basically being squeezed together by gravity and heating it up. The blue, okay, is where we think the dark matter is. Now that's incredible, right? Because if you think about it, the dark matter seems to be it might not even be correlated with where the actual mass is. It might actually be in other places. And the way we made this map, okay, is through gravitational lensing, through looking at the background galaxies behind, and you can see, right, there's some certain orientations of ellipticity over here, of these things. And from that, we actually mapped where the dark matter is. I mean, that's incredible, right? We can't see it, this thing. It doesn't interact with light or shine or things, but we can still measure it. And now the great thing about this is, once we have a formula or we have an equation like that for velocities and for the potential energy that we live in, we can start making what are known as computer simulations. What do? We get two particles, okay, and they're interacting together. So there's the gravitational force. Then we start adding things like dark matter, like dark energy, and things like that, in order to see in a computer, if we put in these rules, how will it actually turn up to look like? And I think if I have this, I'll just try and run this video. This is the latest video, fresh hot off the press. There we go. So you'll be able to see, okay, this is time since the Big Bang, 1 billion years. Okay, we're 13 billion years after the Big Bang. These are the dark matter. You can see, right? It's forming clumps already. You can see these filaments. This is because of the way we think that the dark matter is interacting between one part of the universe and the other. You can start to see now, you know, galaxies or proto-galaxies starting to form. Clouds of gas being pulled together by gravity, okay, until, remember, if it's too hot, the electron gets shot away from hydrogen, it's got too much energy and gets pulled off. But when it cools down, the universe, the electron can get captured, and you can start to form hydrogen. Once hydrogen forms, and another hydrogen forms, gravity keeps pulling it together, and then it explodes, and you start to see these explosions happening. You're seeing them over here. And this is why the physics gets super interesting here, because now it's nonlinear. Because now you have an explosion, you've got a shockwave driving, and you've got star formation and galaxy formation along certain lines. And this is why you're starting to get these structures that have in the galaxy, as George said. This is why you get those nonlinear things like the continents, why you get the preferential lines of things across it. Okay, this is still 7 billion years. There's still 6 billion years to go before it comes to us. And this is still interacting. The universe is expanding. It's decelerating slightly, but now it's going to start expanding very, very quickly for no particular reason. If we knew what the particular reason is, we'd write down what the equation of dark energy is. We know what the equation of dark energy, Jim told us, in the same way as we wrote down the equation for dark matter. He wrote us down the equation of dark energy. He said it's constant and it depends on these things. It doesn't change with time. This is 10.1 billion years. So we're looking back, okay, just 3 billion years ago. It's actually quite a recent universe. You can see, right, it's becoming sparse. It almost starts to look a bit like the sky through a telescope now. We're actually quite close to what we're seeing. You can see interacting, merging galaxies. Galaxies are merging. Why, we can calculate how many are there. Did the elliptical galaxies come through mergers, the ones that Chiara was showing us, or were they made early on in the universe? You can start seeing. Now this is where we are now. You can start seeing spirals and things like this. And this is why these simulations are incredible, okay? It is incredible what we can do now. And what we do now is we compare. Okay, what we've seen in the simulation and what we see in the sky. And the nice thing about these supercomputers, okay, is you can tweak. You are actually God. You actually sit there and say, I'm going to build this universe. I'm going to put this much baryons in it. I'm going to put this much galaxies in. I'm going to say the star formation rate, it's incredibly important how quickly stars form. The star formation rate is this. And I compare it, right? Because the whole point of the scientific method, you make a guess. Anyone can guess. Okay, you can go and ask, you know, the professor of philosophy of liberal arts and tell him, listen, I need a theory of gravity. Give me one, please. What do? You compute the consequences. You run it through the computer simulation that is calculating all how it's working at things. But that's not enough. Then you have to look at the sky. Then you have to go to your government, to the EU, tell them, listen, I need a really expensive telescope. Because I can see. I can see to my solar system. That's not going to tell me anything. And after you've gone there, you spent 1.5 billion euros on a satellite. You've sent it up into space. Only then you go back to the philosophy professor and tell him, I'm sorry, that theory of gravity that you gave me, it's not working well for me. He tells you, okay, well, try this. This is why theory is really easy. They just tell you what to try everything. You just go, okay, try this. Okay, I'll go. I'll point my satellite at another place. Look at it. Okay, I'm sorry, it's not working again. The question is, it's actually really difficult to do these guesses, right? Because you're constrained. You're constrained. You know, basically, What experiments are doing is it's cutting parameter space for you. You can't say, look, there is a person who is, there are the angels pushing the pendulum. It can't be, because if I make the pendulum a little bit heavier, or the angels suddenly get stronger, and they start pushing, it cannot be. There has to be a theory. And the whole point of physics and the nature of physics is to join all these forces together. Okay, this is what we want to do, and this is what we want to inspire people to do. The electromagnetic force, the electrostatic force, goes as 1 over r squared. Gravity goes as 1 over r squared. What's happening? Why? What's so special about this 1 over r squared? Actually, it turns out, you know, it goes as the surface area of a sphere, for example, right? As 4 pi r squared. So it's getting weaker. But there are forces that don't. I'll give you an example, right? All of you know that there is another force that is stronger than the electrostatic force. What's that? The force that keeps two protons sitting next to each other in a nucleus. And it's incredible, right? That strong nuclear force. It's so strong. And then you don't see it anywhere else in the world. It's so strong. And it's so short. It works on a very tiny short distance. And you can calculate how strong it is by the distance, for example. Okay, you can do it with quantum mechanics. And Now I'm going to stop here. But before I stop, I want to tell you something. We were joking, right, in the beginning when I told when you guessed dark matter. You said, well, you know, I said, well, what, maybe the physics doesn't really work at that scale. Maybe it's a different physics. It's a different laws of it. But this is actually true, right? If you make that pendulum, this pendulum, okay, and you make it shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter until the distance between my hand and the ball is a proton and an electron, you find that the laws of physics have completely changed. Okay? You've basically come into the realm of quantum. So now you have to ask yourself the question, what if things are changing at the much larger scales? Now that can either tell you something. There must be a hidden thing that joins these things at another level that we still don't understand. There might be degrees of freedom. There might be those things about symmetry that I was telling you, that at the very beginning, when everything looked flat, there was a symmetry. Everything was symmetric. As soon as something happened, all the symmetry changed. And that symmetry changing is what we call symmetry breaking. Okay, started imposing things, started imposing rules, for example, started changing things. So these are the people, these are all the guesses of what dark matter might be. From extra dimensions, 5, 6, I think 12 now is the latest favorite, to little Higgs, small Higgs bosons, big Higgs bosons, different things. Different quantum chromodynamics. Quantum chromodynamics is the force that holds the nucleons together. It's a strong force. Okay, all these things, warm dark matter, antisymmetric dark matter, all this crazy stuff. Remember, unless they agree with the experiment, throw them away. Throw them away. Go back, ask, go to your prep 5 student, tell him, listen, I need another candidate for dark matter. That's all. Thanks.